don't really remember when I first began calling myself a feminist. I wish I knew who or what had introduced me to the concept, but I am sure that I was a feminist long before I even knew what the word meant. For a lot of this, I have my childhood to thank. I grew up in a liberal, progressive family that always encouraged me to be as independent as I could. You see, we have three sisters and no brothers at home, so the family was keen that we be as ambitious and driven and tough as they encouraged their sons to be. And so, when I won a prize, or topped my class, or refused to cry when I fell off my bike, my father's friends told him it was like he had a son. School was a similar story. I enjoyed my studies, I loved my extracurriculars, I loved to draw, and I really enjoyed the debate game, mostly because it was a time my being opinionated was actively encouraged. It's possible to say that I grew up being a feminist, surrounded by feminists who never used that term to describe themselves. The only difference between then and now is that we were feminists by default. We believed that my being a girl shouldn't stop me from achieving anything, and that made us feminists. Simple enough, right? And yet, the fact that I was a feminist by default made me do some decidedly unfeminist. By the time I was 15, I heard myself being called the son of the family a dozen times. By school teachers, by friends of my parents, by distant relatives. For those of you here who are not familiar with this term, being the son of the family has nothing to do with gender. The son of the family is ambitious. The son of the family is somebody who makes them proud. The son of the family may or may not be female, but is decidedly not feminine. I consistently enjoyed my time in school, and I consistently tried to live up to this honorary title by rejecting anything that seemed frivolous. A couple of my classmates went as far as to jokingly say that my head girl badge should have been revoked for a head boy badge, because according to them, I'd worked harder than him for a recent event. Now, 15-year-old me was proud of these compliments, was proud of 12-year-old me for calling me unstupid, was proud of 13-year-old me for refusing to wear skirts, was proud of 14-year-old me for spending more time on math than art, even though I enjoyed both these things. At 16, though, I did something decidedly rotten of the family life. After I appeared for my 10th grade board exams, I told my parents and my teachers that I wanted to pursue a creative field. I wasn't sure back then if I wanted to be a fine artist or an architect or a designer, but I was sure I didn't want to be an engineer or a CEO or a lawyer. When I look back at the reactions I got at this news from absolutely random people, I can actually compare it to the five stages of grief. Shock and denial is distant relatives telling me that I should take science in the 11th and 12th anyway, you know, since this was probably a phase, and that I should keep my options open, which is basically Indian for study engineering. Pain and guilt was them wondering if that birthday gift of crayons when I turned 10 is what had nudged me towards this rebellion. Bargaining is a favorite of mine. A guidance counselor telling me, in all seriousness, that I should attend 6-hour daily classes for medical entrance exam, along with daily classes I was already attending for architecture and design entrances, not to mention school. Never mind that biology was probably my least favorite subject. She was proud of herself for coming up with a creative solution that allowed me to pursue what I like, while also, and I quote, not wasting my intelligence. Depression was probably the realization sinking in when I chose art as my elective over, say, computer science or biology or economics. And I wish I could say most of those people ever reached acceptance, which is the final stage, but most of them are, at best, at a new fifth stage, confused resignation. I say confused because they're not people who hate art or design in particular. They have kids who read comics, they watch films with their families, and some of them even regularly spend exorbitant sums, you know, money that they earn by doing serious work, on designs from Chanel and Gucci and Louis Vuitton. I say confused because they seem to think that art or design is something that you resort to studying when you're not smart enough to study science. And it may sound funny, but this is the exact dismissive attitude we're trained to have towards anything feminine in general. That someone resorts, not chooses, to spend their time applying makeup because they have nothing better to do with their time. That someone resorts to expressing themselves or crying because they're not capable of being tough. And that at 16, I resorted to being the daughter of my family because I could no longer handle being the son. As I grew older, I veered closer and closer to the artistic side of design. I went from studying art as one subject out of six to studying design full-time to majoring in graphic design rather than more industrial design. My college really focuses on trying to use your skills as a tool to solve problems. The one thing that did remain constant, though, was people's confusion, and eventually even that gave way to condescension. I've lost count of the number of times somebody asked me what I do other than make pretty things, and insisted that even the best visual artists never really use their skills for problem solving. Now I'm telling you this story the way I'm saying it today, but the truth is that this was a very different story in my head 2 years ago, or even up until a few months ago. Yes, I had a dozen feminist idols and influences, and I had a dozen visual artists I really looked up to. But I also had 2 decades of conditioning telling me that I was only making pretty things, and that graphic design was decidedly feminine, and therefore frivolous. And like I had rejected anything feminine in my personal life, I decided to reject anything feminine in my professional life as well. So what came about was that all my work had to be solving problems instantly. Not problems I personally cared about, problems I was told I had to care about. The problem had to be universally relevant, so that when I put my work out there, people would accuse me of wasting my time on something that only bothered a select few. I took my design seriously, and I took myself even more seriously. Even when I was satisfied enough with the project to put it out there and publish it online, I felt like the people appreciating it were people who already agreed with my views. So in internet terms, I thought I was creating an echo chamber. But at the same time, when someone criticized my work, that felt personal too. So it was basically a lose-lose situation. And every single time I had an idea, it had to pass through layers and layers and layers of red tape before I actually began to put it on paper. This is probably why 90% of the ideas I had in the last few years stayed ideas in my head and never turned into projects. I think the biggest injustice I did to my work at this time was that I never thought about what I wanted it to be. I only thought about what I didn't want it to be. Just pretty or silly or cosmetic. So naturally, in this situation, what resulted was work that was correct at best. My color palettes were right, and my typography was proper, and my illustrations were simple. Basically, what used to begin with a fun and imaginative idea ended in a project that was utterly correct, decorous, and boring. It's apt that I speak about this next part at a TEDx event, because its foundation is built on ideas worth spreading. Anyone in the crowd who's watched a TED talk knows how powerful ideas are. You know that ideas have the potential to change the world. But here's the thing. Ideas are also incredibly fragile. Ideas are not static. And ideas, above all, are not immortal. Which meant that every single time I hit my shiny new idea with self-doubt and a fear of irrelevance and a long list of things I didn't want it to be, it became less and less potent in my head until it just didn't seem worth turning into a project. You're probably waiting for a twist in the story by now, because if there isn't one, who the hell invited me to get up here and speak for 18 minutes? Predictably, the twist came when I was thrown out of my comfort zone. Earlier this year, I went to France for 5 months on an exchange semester, and moving to another continent is what it took to show me that I had been raised by like a son, which meant that I had to call my mother with stupid doubt every time I did my laundry or boiled an egg, and that the first time I made spaghetti, half of it was crunchy and the other half overcooked. Since the college was in a small town in France, barely anyone understood English, and nobody understood my French. To top all of this off, my classes were in French as well, which meant that any contributions I could have to discussions were severely limited. So here I was, an aspiring communicator, whose primary communication method was suddenly impaired. It was disorienting, to say the least. Now it was obviously difficult to converse with my classmates, but they were friendly enough. But every time they asked me where I was from and I said India, I saw this look. If you're a person of color who's been abroad, you know this look. And if you're a woman of color who's been around woke people, you definitely know this look. It's this look that says, I'm not sure if I should pity you or be in awe of you, and there's no third option. Some of the girls were more forthcoming and told me that even though India seemed really exotic and wonderful, they never planned on visiting because it just seemed too scary. Of course, this bothered me. And initially I was tempted to dismiss this as just another stereotype that people in the West have about India. So I did. But then as the weeks passed by, my primary exposure to India also came through reading the news. And I realized why this stereotype had begun to exist in the first place. Not only is there a shocking number of crimes against women reported every single day, the way these crimes are reported is equally appalling. Just about every article out there about rape or sexual assault seems to imply, if not outright say, that if the victim had been slightly more conservative, or dressed a little more carefully, or gone home a little earlier, or drank a little less, she could have avoided being in that situation. I realized how often victim blaming formed a part of everyday conversations. And worst of all, I realized that every time the conversation of victim blaming is brought up, it's dismissed because apparently women have bigger problems. Now it's very amusing to me when some people take themselves so seriously that they believe that some problems don't even deserve to be solved by them. It's a paradox of sorts. Imagine a superhero movie where a woman is walking down a dark street alone and somebody snatches her purse and runs away. And she says, "Help me, I'm being robbed." And there comes our superhero, cape blazing behind him. But instead of helping the woman, he tells her, "Don't you know women in other countries are being raped and murdered? Stop complaining, you're so much better off." And my favorite part about this scenario is that he does nothing to help the women who were raped or murdered either. He just uses them as a justification to not help the woman who got robbed. By this time, I had seen that despite playing my work incredibly safe, or maybe because of it, I wasn't getting the kind of results that I wanted. I spent years being so terrified of making mistakes that I ended up not making anything at all. So maybe because I felt like I didn't have all that much to lose, I decided to take the risk of uncensoring my work and going with my instincts. The project that emerged out of this, called the Good Victim Startup Pack, plays with puns, visual and verbal. It uses bold, clashing fonts and it borrows its aesthetic from shamelessly frivolous Indian vintage magazines. It took me more than 2 months to complete this project along with my classroom projects, but it was by far the most unapologetic thing I had ever created. This project got the eye of Iman Sheikh, one of the women I had grown up admiring, and she gave it its first big platform. And then as things on the internet do, the project snowballed and caught the eye of a lot of different major media platforms. Now after the initial exhilaration passed, I realized that my work was finally doing what I became a graphic designer to start difficult conversations. And I think the reason it's been able to start a conversation was because for the first time I was speaking about something I truly cared about. Not something I thought people wanted to hear. Not something I thought I should care about. Something I was genuinely passionate about. And I wish I could say that criticism of this project didn't faze me at all, but it began to affect me a lot less than it used to. I'm going to give you a minute with one of my favorite quotes by one of my favorite designers. As grateful as I am for all the opportunities and recognition that my work has gotten this year, I can't help but wonder what would have happened if I started doing things by design rather than by default sooner. What if I decided to be the daughter of my family by design, creating my definition of it rather than expecting and accepting what other people expected of it? What if I learned to work by design, not using its default definition, creating my definition of what I wanted my work to accomplish? And what if, most importantly, I learned to be a feminist by design, questioning other definitions more, so I created mine better. It's impossible to think about this without an incident that took place in my first year of design. We have a course called Environmental Perception, as a part of which the entire batch goes and stays in a village in Gujarat for a week to observe and document different aspects of the land. Most of us had never stayed in a village before, so our only exposure to that kind of life was secondhand, through stories and films and media. I remember the day before we were supposed to leave, our coordinator took us aside and told us something that confused us. She said, "Remember, you're going to the village to observe and document. They have a very different way of life and a lot of thoughts that you probably don't agree with or understand. You're not going there to judge, and you're not going there to uplift or help them. You're going there to observe, document, and if you care enough, reflect." Now to 100 eager young designers, none of this made any sense. What had seemed like a grand expedition to solve big problems with our skills suddenly became so much less exciting. In our heads, the villagers were facing thousands of major hurdles. You know, child marriage and water shortage and lack of education and lack of social freedoms. In our heads, the villagers were just waiting for these things. What our coordinator had said made a little more sense once we stayed with the villagers. But it makes even more sense with each other passing by. If I could go back in time and tell myself one thing that could help me be a better feminist by design, it would be that you don't have to save the world. A lot of design and a lot of feminism fails because it tries to save the world. Don't get me wrong, I don't mean we should be less ambitious. And I don't mean we should set easier goals for ourselves so our chances of failing become lower. I definitely don't mean we should lower our standards for what we expect ourselves to accomplish. Have big, gigantic goals that you believe in, but don't try to save the world. The moment we try to save someone, we put ourselves on a pedestal, and we miss the opportunity to see who we are working for as whole human beings. We look at them as objects of pity, always with sympathy, never with empathy, and that is where we fail. When we stop trying to save the world with lofty design, we see ourselves as we are. Human beings, more privileged, slightly luckier, not better than the people we're working for. We see our work as it is, an attempt to solve a problem, not a guarantee to solve every problem all at the same time. More importantly, we understand that in design, feminism, and everything else, there will always be bigger problems to solve. This doesn't mean that the smaller ones are not worth solving. And in my experience, people who invalidate your work by telling you you should be focusing on bigger problems usually solve neither. I'm a workaholic and I still wear that badge with pride. But lately I've been understanding that the reason I felt that pressure for my work to save the world came from being a workaholic. How many other ways are there to justify working 16-hour days every day? But humanizing design is what helped me fall in love with the process rather than the specific outcome, to the point where I no longer needed a justification to work 16-hour days. Maybe it's why I'm learning to be less defensive about my work as well. Because the point is no longer to make a great poster, or a beautiful visual identity, or a flawless interface. The point is no longer to burn my letters so perfectly that nobody can find technical fault with what I'm doing. The point is to find the best solution for the problem that I came to solve. And you know what? Sometimes, just sometimes, the best way to do that is to pick up a pen, forget about the rules, and make something different. Thank you.